my chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace.
Good evening, Cape Ann and the North Shore. Welcome to the Good News Program. My name is Bill Robinson, and I'm the host for this evening's program. And this is part two of a two-part series. That's good, Hummel. We have with us tonight, part two, Monpeth, is that right?
Monpeth,
Carr, from Liberia. And we're going to pick up where we left off at the last program. I just want to thank you for taking the time, brother, and coming and visit with us, because we know that the trip was an arduous trip.
It was.
To say the least. You know, in fact, he's wearing my clothes. They lost his clothes on Delta Airlines, and I rented him the clothes. I said, if you spill coffee,
you
then there's a cleaning charge. Come on. I love him. So he's going to pick up where he left off. You were in your house. The war is winding down, the Civil War, but you guys are in a very dangerous atmosphere. You got 100 people in your house, in the yard, and all over the place. Go ahead.
And then God, and then I read, and God says, use my word for your safety.
Mm.
And so I call everybody in the house mm-hmm. to come in the living room. People are standing on the porch, and I said, we're going to pray.
Yeah.
Where the Bible say 1,000 shall fall,
mm-hmm.
we say 1,000 bullets or 1,000 rockets,
mm-hmm.
but they shall not come near us. We had a word of prayer for less than 5 minutes, and we declared that we stay in this house. 1,000 bullets or rockets may fall by our side, but it shall not come near us.
I just want to interrupt. You hear what he said? He declared. That's different than going, oh, Daddy, please. No, he declared because he knows he is the Son of the living God, and he has a right to declare, and Daddy wants him to declare. There's a big difference between declaration and pleading.
And pleading.
No, no, no. He's declaring because he's a son of God. So they declared Psalm 91.
And then we prayed, less than 5 minutes. And as all this fighting went on, all this shelling went on, all the firing went on, we could only hear tears and cries from the homes near us. There were people being killed. A neighbor of mine who was on his way to the U.S. with his family was dismembered when a mortar round fell and cut his right hand off, and he was virtually pulling his intestines when he was dying in the next house beside me. When the firing ceased, a couple of hours later, not a single bullet touched my home.
Mm.
Not a single mortar round touched our home. Every single person, 100 plus men, women, and children, survived the war, while people who ran to the U.S. Embassy thinking it was safe were killed. But God kept us in that house safe when the neighbors were crying. And that's why God said, use my word.
Hmm.
Use my word.
You said verse 7.
Psalm 91, verse 7. 1,000 shall fall by thy side.
And on the seventh day, what happened? Nigeria.
On the seventh day, there was a mandate. The president, Charles Taylor, had issued a command to his soldiers to take this war from house to house, street to street. And these guys were prepared to kill anything that moved. And on the ultimatum, Liberia experienced a miracle because Nigeria moved into Liberia with military intervention and moved between the rebels and the government. And the fighting ended the same day. And Charles Taylor was forced to leave the country the same day to go to Nigeria for safety.
Wow.
And that's how God preserved a remnant right in my house by the power of his word.
So, when you say, I trust the word of God, I trust what it says with the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Number one, you know who you are. Number two, you know what he says. What he says, he means what he says and says what he means. That's it.
Ultimate.
Yeah, there's no playing with it.
There's no negotiation with what God says.
Yeah, right. So now the war's over. You don't have a job.
Oh, Bill, this is phenomenal because I have learned God step by step.
Yes.
I got married 2001. The war is over 2003. Mm. No job. Mm. Monrovia is picking up. Debris everywhere. Mass graves everywhere. The Red Cross will hire, but only a limited number of people. I go to church in October 2003, and the pastor was preaching, the Reverend Edward E. Nippe. And he said, God has spoke to my heart that every man in this church bring an offering on Watch Night at the close of the old year 2003 and the entrance of the new year 2004. Bring an offering. And my wife had received some money from her mother in the U.S. And so we had $25, $25 US. And she said, let's give it. And I'm wondering if this woman is crazy. This is all we have. She said, let's give it. Because there's something about the seed. Like I ministered yesterday at the church, you are able to count the number of seeds that can come from one orange, but you can't count the number of oranges that can come from one seed. So she said, we sold this $25. We put the money in the envelope, wash night, and gave it to God. I got a job in 3 months to pay me $167 from nowhere. And so my wife and me knelt down and made a vow to God. And if people mean business for change, make a vow. God is a deal maker. He's a businessman. That's why I love the full gospel businessman. And we said to God, God, from today's date, we make a vow as a family that you ask for 10, we will give you a 20 of all that you give us. We said it. God heard it. And God began to bless. I work with Maersk, the shipping lines.
Yep.
And then I work with DHL.
Yep.
The courier company for 3 years. And I resigned January 3rd, 2009 from DHL and set up my own business January 2009. Bill, I have a staff of 7 right now, including me, 8. I pay my people on time. I'm saying this to tell you that business can't stop coming. God is baffling us. God is baffling us. Every day we have jobs. Apart from that, I have people who walk to my office on a daily basis for alms. And God has said to me, your ministry is not pastor. Your ministry is not evangelist. Your ministry is backside ministry, where you do my will without the eyes of the world knowing. Because I who see in secret will reward you openly.
Ah, right.
And that's what we are doing right now. And so America is going through a phase right now. Everything that rises must come down. And everything that comes down must go up. America is going through a phase right now where people who used to afford may not be affording what they used to have before.
Right.
And you come to that place where you're about to give up, you're about to quit, and you think things are not working and the promises of God are lies. Listen to me, make a deal with God. Mm. When it comes to tithing, go beyond. Tithing is man's phenomena. God asks for a free will offering. Try God, like Hannah. She said, God, if you give me a male child, I will give him back to you without having a child, without being pregnant. She made a deal with God. And the Bible said God gave her the male child to keep his side of the deal. Mm. When she got a male child, she weaned him. She gave him back to the Lord to keep her side of the deal. But the story doesn't end there. God gave her 5 more children. Mm. A barren woman is not a mother of 6 because of a deal. Mm. So Americans, wherever you are, you may be going through the worst moments of your life. God is waiting for people who will step up and make a deal with him. Mm. Because he watches over his word to perform it. Mm. If God spoke something, he was not under coercion to say it. He said it because he can do it. He said it because he wants to do it. Yeah. He said it because he has the ability to do it.
He just quoted Jeremiah 1:12.
He watches over his word to perform it for his sake.
For his sake.
Yeah.
Because he is truth.
Do you know that when David became king,
yeah,
he sat down in the palace enjoying life and he asked, is there anybody left from the house of Saul that I may show kindness for Jonathan's sake?
Yeah.
Mephibosheth didn't enjoy the goodness of David because of him. Mm-hmm. He enjoyed it because of Jonathan. God wants to bless his people, not because of the people, but because of Jesus' sake.
Amen.
But he's looking for deal makers
to
sign a pact.
This is, you know, I love what you're saying. You know, we were talking before the show and we said, you know, what's the difference? Where's America going? It's on a fast slide down the tubes. And we said, you know what? we have now got gay marriage. The president supports it, okay? Now we have abortions. That's okay. That's not what the Word of God says, all right? And I want to say this, and I want you to confirm it. This country sent the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton. You didn't see this on the news. This didn't come on our news, because our news is controlled by the enemy, as far as I'm concerned, all right? She went over to West Africa and the continent, and she threatened to pull back all financial aid if gay marriage wasn't allowed. Well, what happened when she got there, as soon as she came off the plane on her way to the capital, by the way, the woman who is the president of Liberia is a Christian, okay? People were lined the sides of the road with no gay marriage.
Placards.
No abortion. All the way in. She left, went to Ghana, which is a couple of countries away. Same thing. Say they won't compromise.
As a matter of fact, if you arrive at the airport in Accra, that's the first thing you see at the immigration booth. If you came to this country for homosexuality, for prostitution, for crime, for drugs, we have one advice: turn around. Hillary Clinton did go. The U.S. did threaten African nations that if you don't adopt and legalize gay marriage, we will hurt aid to you. And the tides have changed. In the past, America was sending missionaries to the world to preach Jesus. Never again will African nations accept the dogmas of man. Gay marriage is anti-God.
Right.
And the government, Parliament of Liberia told the U.S., we will not legalize. If that's the only way to get aid, keep your aid.
Right.
But we will not. Ghana, the same thing. As far as East Africa, Zimbabwe, no way. Africa will not adopt gay marriage because it's anti-God. We've come to the point to know that if you can't stand for Jesus, Bill, you will fall for anything.
You'll fall for the enemy, fall for the devil.
You will fall for anything. Yeah. Gay marriage, no way.
Yeah. So I wanted to insert that because we only get what our news wants us to hear.
Yeah.
And that's controlled, you know. This is called the Good News Program. So we're bringing the good news that Jesus Christ is alive and well, and he's changing men's hearts. He's working in there, and he wants the best for his people.
He always does. Oh. That has been a plan from Genesis.
Yeah.
That has been God's original plan. That's why he said to man, have dominion, rule, govern.
Right.
He made the ants, the flies, the pigs, the cows, and he said to Adam, whatever name you call them, that's the name thereof.
Yeah.
It's he gave man dominion, and he gave man sense, but he also gave man free will, the power to choose.
Tell me about the Full Gospel Businessmen in Liberia.
The Full Gospel is a dynamic organization.
Yeah.
I've never been more proud to be the national president.
Oof.
We have young people, older people,
who
want to see this fellowship move to the next level.
Yeah.
And it is going to move.
Yeah.
We've had our obstacles because of the crisis.
Mm-hmm.
We are picking up slowly, but there are signs that the hand and the finger of God has entered our affairs. Like in John 5, when the angel troubled the water, and whoever entered first was healed, the finger of God is involved in the Full Gospel Businessmen Fellowship.
I believe it. I've been involved in it since 1984, and I have seen tremendous move of God. When men allow God to get a hold of their heart, you know, where I think you said yesterday or this morning, I don't remember, but when you seek his face, and he says this so many times in here, seek my face first. Psalm 119, verse 147, he says, before the sun comes up, seek my face. Seek my relationship.
Early when I seek thee, Lord.
Oh, yeah. And when you do that, see, his face means I want his heart.
Yeah.
You know what? So many of Christians today, they don't realize who they are. They haven't got a clue. And all they do is they want his hands.
Mm.
Help me out. And he said, seek my heart first. Seek who I am first. And then I'll move my hands, because then you won't care.
You know the river?
Yeah.
Never set your hope on the river. Set your hope on the Creator.
Mm.
Because the rivers can run dry.
Mm-hmm.
When the seasons change, rivers do run dry.
Mm.
God said to Elijah, go to the brook Kidron.
Mm-hmm.
I've commanded the birds to feed you.
Mm.
Elijah goes to the brook, and God said, eat the meat and bread that the birds bring, but drink from the river. And I believe in my heart that Elijah came to a place of complacency where I have the river, the birds feed me, and God caused the river to go dry. And Elijah was forced to find another location. God doesn't work in any unique way. Like he said to Demas Shakarian, do not limit me.
Yeah.
Don't put me in a box. Give me space for my infinite variety. Because God will never speak to you the way he speaks to me. He will never treat me the way he treats you. He has different ways of doing different things.
You know, we're moving in on 300 programs on this program, okay? We have never, and you can ask the camera people, have never had two alike, not even close. And what you're saying is at the absolute truth. God is unique. He had there's 7 billion of us on planet Earth at the moment, and he treats us all differently. We're unique. We're like, you know, I know you're not crazy about snow.
Oh, don't remind me, please.
He said, is it always this cold? I said, no. I don't find it cold. It's actually about 35 degrees.
I'm from Africa.
A heat wave, all right? But when it snows, there's never a snowflake the same.
Really?
They're all different. You can put them, and they're all different. And that's like us. We're all different, but yet we're the same tied to him, you know? And, you know, I really am excited about what this full gospel businessmen are doing. You're meeting men. And when men become the head of their family the way he says it, then guess what? The rest of the family follows.
The word father means source.
Mm.
The word father, Abba.
Go ahead.
Means the source. Yeah. So men came out of God.
Go
Women
ahead.
Came out of men.
Uh-oh.
So when the man, man was made for God.
Yeah.
Woman was not made for God.
Right.
Woman was made for man.
It says it in here.
It says it. So when the man, when the father, when the source has a connection to the ultimate source who is God, your family is set up for God's favor.
Mm-hmm.
Favor means endowment. Your family, if the father is not in the place of a father, and even if the mother is safe, it is the grace of God taking that family, because the anointing flows from Aaron's beard, and that's from the head. Then it drops to the skirt, mm-hmm. and then the rest of the body sees it. You are out of order if the anointing flows directly to the skirt and not the head.
Mm-hmm.
So you will be operating but by the grace and mercy of God. I don't say this to downplay women in any way, but it's God's order that the man rule his household. He said, can I hide from Abraham anything? Saying he will rule his household well and he will lead his children after me, not Sarah, but Abraham. Mm.
Yeah.
So the full gospel will bring men back to God.
You know, I'll tell you this. We've been married 52 years, and this has been a progression for us. I mean, we're enjoying the best time of our life right now. But I will say this. When I treat my wife like a queen, guess what she treats me like?
Like a king. Sure.
I like it.
There's no queen without a king.
And, you know, it's fantastic. You know, it says a threefold cord is not easily broken. The king and the queen and Jesus, that's what it is. And he's called men, you know, to be the priest, the prophet, and the king in their own home. That's the servant king, to guide, to govern, to correct, to protect, to love, to cherish, to admonish.
Yeah.
And teach the kids 5 things. Teach them the essence of God, all right, the nature of man, the steps necessary for salvation, to teach them about Jesus, and to give them a love for the Word of God. That's what you do. And today we say they go watch TV.
Yeah.
They go to this, and the TV is polluted. I mean, it's polluted. You know, it's polluted. So, but the, you know what I'm saying, Mo? God pours so much into us, all right? And if we become a reservoir that doesn't have an outlet, if the river doesn't flow, then the reservoir becomes contaminated, polluted, stagnant, and it smells.
It smells.
It smells.
It pollutes.
Yeah. So he's called men to be a river of life to their families. I know in my own life, I'm not going into my testimony, but when I changed and he became the center of my life, man, my family changed.
Have you asked yourself why would Eve be deceived by a snake into eating an apple? And she convinced her husband. But when God came in the garden, he asked Adam, not Eve. No matter the decision that is made in your home, if you are a man, you and your wife can discuss. Mm. But the ultimate decision of a Christian man, a Christian home, must come from the Father.
Mm-hmm.
If that Father is in tune with the Father of all,
oh, yeah.
He will make the right decision for his family. Because God will always ask the man, not the woman. God will always ask the man, because Father is source. The nutrient, the strength for the family flows through the Father. So your wife can be safe. If the Father is not safe, the home is out of order.
Right, right. And you know, we talked about this morning, about being out of order.
Mm.
We talked about when the Ark of the Covenant was moved, all right? It was moved. We have two people that have watched this, two sons, for 20 years. And it was like, there's the table, there's the television, there's the sofa. Oh yeah, by the way, there's the Ark. Familiar. So he said, hey, David said, well, what do you think we should do? They didn't pray, they didn't fast. They said, well, put it in a wagon and we'll bring it. But that's not what God said. He said, no, you put it on poles. You put the poles on your shoulder so that you can feel the felt presence of God. Oh, we want to feel good. No, we're in a war zone. We live in a war, but we can still feel the peace of God all the time. You want to feel that presence. So what happened? The wagon stumbled. One of the kids put his hands on it, and he's dead. And David got upset. But the ark represents what we have in the church today. Methods, formulas, strategies, and techniques. They've eliminated the Holy Ghost.
Revelation is out of the church.
Ooh.
It's dogmas.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's programs.
Yeah.
The funny thing about our scripture is that God really wanted the ark returned.
Mm.
But no matter how earnestly God wanted the ark returned, it must be returned God's way.
Mm.
And the presence of God should not be carried by animals. The church has neglected the presence of God. Remember Jesus said, these don't praise me, the stones?
Mm.
He always has a substitute.
Yeah.
But always put yourself in a place where you become the target of God's blessing. The ark must only be carried by men.
Put yourself in the place. First of all, he says in 1 Chronicles 15, I think it's 13, you're out of order. You can be in the will, but out of his order.
Okay? Out of order.
But he said, you just said it. Put yourself in a place. Samuel, 1 Samuel 3:9, the kid wakes up, he hears a voice. God hadn't spoken for years. Eli says, go back to bed. Does it again. Go back to bed, Samuel. Third time, Eli wakes up and says, whoa, 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 whoa. God is speaking to him. Get yourself in a place so that you can hear him. Listen, make it the priority. This is what Full Gospel Businessmen is saying to the men out there. Make it a priority to get yourself in a position so that you can hear God and be the duly authorized representative that he wants you to be. He won the victory at the cross. He wants men to implement it and enforce it.
That's the mandate.
Listen, this book, my friends, look at it, is pretty simple. It doesn't take rocket science. I'll tell you what it does. It takes bright guys to screw it up. This is simple. Huh? This is the manufacturer's handbook.
Oh.
Do it.
I was at a funeral one day, and the guy was preaching about coming back, Jesus coming back, second coming, and all that stuff. And God said to me, he was talking about audit.
Mm.
And God said to me, when an auditor comes to a company to do audit, what he does is he asks for the policy of the company and goes by it to know if the company has been following the policy. When God made us, he gave us a policy book.
Mm.
And the audit of our lives is only by the book.
Amen.
Have we been operating by this?
Okay. That's it. That's it, Mark. Listen, what we're going to do is just like we did on the first program here. We're going to give the people out there in television land the opportunity to do what you did and I did and the people that are on these cameras and directing the program from inside, to ask Jesus Christ into their life to be their personal Lord and Savior. And I'll tell you what, well, you're going to have people say, well, I don't know if that's true. Then I tell them what, you know what I tell them? Take the 30-day trial off if you got enough guts. In other words, before you go to bed at night, say, I don't know, Jesus, if you're really real. But if you're really real, please show up and tell me who you are and you know, help me get this mess together we call sin out of my life. Would you lead the people?
I want to say to somebody tonight, you've been born in the church, you've been going to church. I was born in a church. I went to church until I gave my life to Jesus. It's one thing to be going to church, but the church is not in you. Mm. The church is not a building. The church is you. Mm. Samuel grew up in the temple, but never knew the voice of God. Mm. He wasn't saved. At 17, 18 years old, when God spoke, he thought it was man. So you may have been going to church all your life. You may have heard messages upon messages. I want to say to you, if you've never come to that place to say, Jesus, I surrender, you are not born again. But I want to give you that chance right now to say, Jesus, I surrender. Put away your pride. Put away your intellect. Put away your Harvard degree. Put away your master's and your PhD. He's the only wise God. Your degree is foolishness. His wisdom is infinite. I want you to bow your heads right now, and I'm going to pray with you. And I want you to stretch your hands to this TV right now and say, Jesus of Nazareth, you are the only God that is true. I've realized that I'm short. I've realized that I cannot weigh in the balance. And I need you, O God, to complete my life. I understand, Lord, that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Today I say, Lord, erase my past. Come into my heart and start a new page, O God. I hold your hand that you will lead me. I declare you as my Lord and Savior today and for the rest of my life. Satan, you have no more power over my life because I belong to Jesus. Mm. I cover myself in the blood of Jesus, the waterfall of cleansing. Right now, in Jesus' mighty name, you are born again.
Whoa. Monk, thank you so much. If you've done that out there tonight and you say, well, okay, what's next? On your screen, there's an address they can get in touch with, because Lone Rangers don't work. They get picked off here. You need fellowship. You need to be with other people of like-minded. Just respond to it. And, you know, it'll be, listen, this isn't fire insurance. This is life insurance, yeah. Folks. You do it, I'll tell you what, you'll start to see a difference. I'm not promising you in Rose Garden. We live in a war zone, but I'll tell you what, I will promise you in the name of Jesus, you will have perfect peace that transcends everything. In the midst of all kinds of, we're not immune to a chaos and all this kind of tribulations. You hear what the man came through, but you will have peace in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Ma, thank you so much. My brother from Africa comes. You know what? I think the tables are turned. The Africans are coming here and getting us fired up for Jesus. Thank you so much, brother.
Amen.
For coming. All right.
Amen.
Thanks out there on television land, you have a great week. God bless you.
My chains are